Hey, good morning. It's great to see all of you here today. This is the day that the Lord has made. That's capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Jehovah, the one and only God. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we are going to rejoice in it. I want to welcome you to this service. My name is Marlon. I'm one of the pastors here at Timberline. And I'd like you to put a picture up, if you would, on the screen. This is a little girl named Tirza. Isn't she cute? Dedication for her, second service. If you want to come to just that part, it's going to be right at the very beginning of the second service. You can stand in the back or sit in the back, and there'll be an opportunity to kind of mix, and you can find your way out right after the dedication. But Tirza Meck, we're going to dedicate her beginning of second service. So we invite you out to that. Anyway, right now I invite you to stand, shake someone's hand, or bump them an elbow, or whatever you want to do, and say good morning, and we're going to stay standing for our time of worship.
Come, let us worship. The mountains shake and crumble at your name. The oceans roar and tumble at your name.
Sings my soul. sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died. My soul, my Savior, God to me, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to me, how great Thou art, how great Thou shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble
you. Jesus, we love you. We sing of your mighty works, of your great works. How great thou art. Our God is a consuming fire, a burning holy with glory and freedom. Our God is the only righteous judge, ruling over us with kindness and wisdom. And we will keep our eyes on you. We will keep our kingdom is Jesus, where your spirit is, there is freedom. There is freedom in this place. Father, we worship you this morning. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
We sang together, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." Can you say amen to that? Amen. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's good too, Dave. That's good too. God has been so good to us. God has blessed us in so, so many ways. And one of the ways that we can show our gratitude back to him is by our giving. And so I'd like to invite the ushers to come up at this time, if they would. You guys just come up here. I'm going to have a prayer with you. Why don't you come over here? Let's bow our heads. Father, we just thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the way you've provided for us. We want to say thank you. Thank you that we have this opportunity to give back to you, to bring you honor, to bring you glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray, amen. You guys can go ahead. It's due to your faithfulness in giving that we're able to help people with counseling. We're able to help people overseas. We're able to run the programs that we run here at Timberline. And we would just want to thank you so much for your faithfulness in tithing and your gifts that are over and above the tithe. I want to take just a couple minutes to catch you up on what's happening around Timberline. We're showing the movie Just Mercy. We're showing that right here at Timberline on August the 30th at 6 p.m. And we'd like to invite you out to that. This is a great movie. I just be upfront about it. It's not really appropriate for children, not because of language or violence or sexual content, but rather for its intensity due to talk around the death penalty and also racism. But I really encourage you to come out to see that movie if you haven't seen it before. It's well worth your time. I think particularly in view of what's going on in our country right now, I think this is a good way for us to be better in touch with what's going on around us. So here's something that's really cool. Maybe you've heard about this production called Esther at Sight and Sound. And they are offering a live stream of their new Easter show. And so it's something that you need to pay for. And so we're going to be tuning into that showing again right here on Sunday evening. You might want to make a note of this. Sunday evening, September 6th, Sunday afternoon, actually, at 3 o'clock. And so we invite all of you to come and join us for that. They're making it very affordable online, but it does cost. So we're getting like a group rate. And then we're going to take an offering to give to Sight and Sound. They're suggesting like $25 per family unit. We're not putting a price tag on that, but we just encourage you to come out and to watch it. I have heard that it's really a great production. I think it only actually showed once. You have a word there, Dave?
We saw it this week.
Did you? Okay.
And it is worth seeing.
Right.
Come to see it.
Right. And the thing of it is that it's pretty hard to get into that right now because it's very limited as far as how many they can show at a time. So we'd really like to bless Sight and Sound because a number of people here at Timberline are employed there. And it's just a great show, and it's a great organization. So, again, that's September the 6th. That's it at 3 p.m. I just want to let you know that our move-up Sunday, like when the kids move up in grade, is going to be August the 30th. And these changes, the move-up Sunday, will only take place when we are indoors. So we're going to clearly announce the new classrooms the first Sunday that we're inside after the 30th of August. So that's just to give you a little heads up on that. If you have any question about that, you can talk with either Bethany Kaufman or Margaret Huber. I want to just remind you again of our Clarion Call Sunday. We will not be meeting next Sunday here. We will not be meeting. And on this Sunday, we are inviting you to live out our Clarion Call, receiving, rebuilding, restoring. And we're asking you to live that out that Sunday without coming together, just to kind of get us out of the box a little bit. Last week we heard from Lindsay about what she's planning on doing on Clarion Call Sunday. And we also heard from Brian Snyder, and they talked a little bit about it. If you missed that, you can go back and see it online. It's online. And this week I'm going to invite Dave and Betty Meyer up. They're going to come up, and they're going to tell you what they're going to do on our Clarion Call Sunday, which is next Sunday. They're going to invite any of you that would like to join them in that. Why don't you come right here so that you can get in on the video here? Who's going to talk? Dave's going to talk. Well, why don't you argue about that? Come over this way. Come over this way a little bit. Yeah, there you go.
I don't know how many of you noticed your handout today, but it's the title of it is In Such a Time as This. And I think that in such a time as this, really feeling called at one of the most powerful things that our response individually or as a church is prayer. And so next Sunday, we're inviting anyone that wants to come to our house, and it's going to be what I like, what we call it here, prayer and reflection.
Okay.
And it'll sort of follow that theme. But it'll just be basically a time of praying about our world, our community, our church situations. And I just think that we can't overdo it. So anyway, we're going to...
Next Sunday, and what's the time on that? Or maybe you're going to tell us.
Yeah, next Sunday at 10:30 at our place. We'll be outside if it's... okay, but we have plenty of room to accommodate inside or out, so either way. And then we're going to follow that with a meal. You can bring a covered dish to share, and we'll do that afterwards.
Okay, so is there a sign-up sheet, or they should just call you?
You can call me, or I laid a sign-up sheet out here so that we have an idea how many are coming.
All right, thank you. And their invitation, their information is in the church directory if you need their address or phone number to call them.
Plus, I think we can handle a pretty good-sized crowd. So,
they have a good-sized house, and if it gets too big upstairs, they'll go downstairs. If it gets too big, they'll go outside, right? So plenty of room for you. So next Sunday, what Lisa and I are going to do for this Clarion Call Sunday is we plan to Zoom a Bible study out of Isaiah 58. And this is specially designed for those, it's anyone is invited into that, but particularly for those that are vulnerable to COVID-19 and aren't getting around, we're going to make this known and put it out to the church. So we're going to Zoom in that time, and we'll do that at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. If you're interested, contact me or contact the office, and we'll get you the link that it takes to get in on that Zoom. So I'd like to invite the ushers up again for a bucket offering. And this is an offering for those of you that are guests. This is an offering that we do every Sunday, what we call our offering for extreme poverty. You guys can go ahead. And every penny that goes in, and dollar, and $100 bill, and $1,000 bill that goes into this bucket goes to our village that we partner with in Guatemala. This does not go to the travel of the team that's going, but this goes directly to our village. As you know, that we have given over $20,000 in the last couple months to help them with food. We are probably going to be giving some more money for food and also towards the next project. There's a meeting Thursday night. If you didn't read it in Capture a Moment in our newsletter, there is a meeting Thursday night at 7 o'clock here in the lounge at Timberline. For anyone who's interested in going on that trip, it's the last week in February. So I just want to make you aware that if you're interested, either come that night or let me know if you're not able to attend for some reason. Let me know that you're interested in that, and we will plan accordingly. And even if you are planning on coming, it would be helpful if you let us know just so we can be prepared for that. It's a really interesting verse in Joel chapter 2, verse 28 and 29. It goes this, "And afterwards I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions." So if you want to know, men, whether you're old or young, it's whether you have dreams or visions. Simple as that. I think I'm probably in the dreaming age there. "Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in these days." I just want to talk with you before a couple minutes about that verse. I believe that God has poured out his spirit on our sons and our daughters. And I want to say this. I think churches that don't give a voice to the sons and the daughters, they're going to die. We have to pass this vision on to our sons and our daughters. And at Timberline Church, we have made a special effort to be able to give a voice to our sons and our daughters. This isn't a feminist movement here, folks. Just want to say that. So if you're worried, just chill. If you don't know what we believe about this, go to our website, we'll tell you. It's there. But God has poured out our spirit on our young men and our young ladies. And from time to time, we're going to give them an opportunity to have a voice. And so this Sunday morning, A.J. Beyer, he's kind of like a son to me. A.J. lived with us for a couple weeks, I think, his senior year. That was fun. And A.J. Beyer is going to bring the message this morning. I'll bring him up in a minute. And then the next Sunday, which is the 23rd, are we going to be here? No. Okay. Or you'll be by yourself. Okay. If you do come, the door might be locked too. And then the following Sunday, which would be the 30th, if I have that right, Ashley King is going to bring a message to us. Because God has poured out his spirit on Ashley King, and God has been speaking some things into her life that we want to have her share with us. Here's what I want you to know. AJ and Ashley, they're not campaigning. They didn't ask to do this. In fact, one of them said, I'm terrified. But they're going to do it because they're called to do it. So I just want you to know that the elders have asked them to bring these messages, and that's what that's about. So AJ is going to share with us this morning. You have some sermon notes. You get a sneak preview into what's going on. And he's also, in his message this morning, is going to address some things about next Sunday that I think will be helpful. So AJ, come on up here, bud, and I want to pray with you. Put your stuff in there. Let's bow our heads. Father, we just pray this morning right now for AJ, and we thank you that your spirit has come upon him. We thank you that he has prophesied and that he has seen visions and that you have spoken to him. So, Father, we pray this morning that you would open our hearts to hear everything that he has to share with us today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Would you give AJ a warm Timberline welcome?
Excuse me one second. You know, I'm 22 and you would think I would know how to work an iPad by now. I feel like this is an opposite problem for someone like Marlon, but here we are. All right, thank you. Good morning, Timberline.
Good morning.
Thank you. So it's an honor and a privilege to be with you all here this morning. As Marlon said, I'm AJ Beyer, and I am not a pastor here at Timberline. I'm here this morning because God has been teaching me some things this year through testimony, and I want to share these things with you. Not because I'm well-educated in the Bible or more experienced in the faith, but because God can use any one of us, and this morning he wants to use what he's been teaching me to hopefully encourage you. To get the full picture of what God has been doing in my life, I feel that you should know some things about me. First of all, I only graduated from high school back in 2017, and I dropped out of college after my first year at Marymount Manhattan College, in which I was going to get my degree in a BFA in acting. Needless to say, I dropped out because there was no purpose in me continuing my degree, and there really isn't anything you can get with a BFA in acting. But it did bring me back here to Timberline and to Lancaster County. When I first moved home, I thought I was an absolute failure by dropping out and moving home. I had no idea who I was, and I had no idea what I was going to do with my life. I had put so much of my time, effort, and energy, and my love into acting and pursuing my dreams that they had become my God. I was living in a perpetual state of idolatry. So, to have this God taken away from me, I thought there was nothing left. But God had other plans for me. What I had considered failure, he made into an opportunity to repent and to follow him. So I gave my life to Jesus last September and began reattending Timberline Church shortly thereafter. God has a beautiful way of turning our failures and shortcomings into opportunities for him to show his glory and bring us back to him. So, in March of this year, 2020, when the world went under because of COVID-19, God once again what I had deemed as a failure into his opportunity. When everything shut down and Timberline staff gathering together Sunday mornings, I was angry. I didn't want to stop meeting because I needed my church. I couldn't fathom not being here every Sunday morning. And then the Lord convicted me. I had made Timberline an idol. And I was angry because God had taken my idol away. You see, I confused my love for the church with my love for attending church. I loved worshiping in the back or on stage to all the songs that got me in the mood for Jesus. I loved seeing my friends and catching up with them and telling them about all the things that God had been teaching me outside of Sunday mornings. I loved listening to sermons so that I could be served and fed spiritually, especially if my quiet times with Jesus had been a little lackluster that week. And I specifically loved hanging out after church and waiting around to see if anyone would invite me over for lunch or make plans with me. Now, understand this. It wasn't what I was doing Sunday mornings that made it sinful. It was why I was doing them that made them so. You see, I was missing out on God's plans and his purpose for the church. And that is why I'm here this morning. I was missing love for my church. And that kind of love, when you really get a hold of it, begins to transform you and can change your life. So, when the Lord confronted me with all this, I asked some natural questions. The first being, what is the church and what is its purpose? Now, I had a lot of time to ponder these questions and to go back into God's word when we all had to shut down in quarantine and we couldn't meet for 12 weeks. I wanted to dive into what the Bible really says about church. And the best part about God's word is that it's trustworthy and unchanging. I would now like to invite Marlon and Lisa up to sing The Bible Stands, and I would encourage you all to stand as well.
So you guys kind of know these songs, this song by now. Stand up, Everett, let's go. Wow, it's a reluctant stand here, AJ, but they're getting
really
up
is.
There. So we're going to sing this song together. We've been singing it for the last 4 weeks, and so we finally got to the last verse, so we'll do the whole thing this morning.
The Bible stands like a rock, undaunted mid the raging storms of time. Its pages burn with the truth eternal, and they glow with the light sublime. The Bible stands, though the hills may tumble, it will firmly stand. Though the earth shall crumble, I will plant my feet on its firm foundation, for the Bible stands. The Bible stands like a mountain towering far above man. Its truth by none ever was refuted, and destroy it they never can. The Bible stands, though the hills may tumble, it will firmly stand. When the earth shall crumble, I will plant my feet on its firm foundation, for the Bible stands. The Bible stands, and it will forever, when the world has passed away. By inspiration it has been given, all its precepts I will obey. The Bible stands, though the hills may tumble, it will firmly stand. When the earth shall crumble, I will plant my feet on its firm foundation, for the Bible Bible stands. The Bible stands. Every test we give it, for its author is divine. By grace alone I will expect to live it and to prove it and make it mine. The Bible stands, though the hills may tumble, it will firmly stand. When the earth shall crumble, I will plant my feet on its firm foundation, for the Bible stands. Can you say amen?
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you, Nefsigers. So, what does the Bible say about church? When the Bible refers to the church, it is known as the bride, the body of Christ, God's family, the Lord's chosen, the assembly of saints, God's children, and his holy ones. Notice that these names are personified. They're references to people, not a building. The word church in the New Testament is the Greek word ekklesia, which means the called out ones. It is a group or an assembly of people. It is a derivative of the verb ekkaleo, which means to call out or to call forth. The church is a group of people that has been called out from the world by God to do his work. I believe we have misused some language over the years when referring to church. We use terms like going to church or doing church. And when we say this, I doubt we mean the church as a group of people. We use these terms in reference to the buildings in which we gather in, or the services that we hold in these buildings. This is more of a temple-like mindset that comes out of the Old Testament. The temple was the dwelling place of God. Specifically, in the center of the temple was known as the Holy of Holies. The Jews would come to the temple to worship and make sacrifices to the Lord to atone for their sins on a regular basis. In a sense, we haven't quite moved away from this idea in our modern era. We still travel to a building on a weekly basis to have our times of teaching and worship. So when we say church, do we really mean temple? If we do, then even the word temple in the New Testament is a reference to us, God's people. 1 Corinthians 3:16, 17 says, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's spirit lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred and you are that temple." So, what is the church? It's a who, not a what. We are the church. We have been called out by God from the world to be his church. And so this brings me to my next question. If we are the church, then what are we supposed to do? If you turn with me in your Bibles, or click if you have it on your phone and you moved into the modern era, to Acts 2:42-47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to everyone as he had a need. Every day they continued to meet in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Now, if you look at this, there are a couple of things here that I want to dissect. First, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. They were devoted. There was a commitment to what was going on in the church. They were devoted to the teachings of the church, and they were devoted to the fellowship of the church. the fellowship being defined as the gathering of the believers and the camaraderie that they shared between themselves. Next, all the believers were together and had everything in common. So what does this mean to have everything in common? I don't think they meant that they all had the same hobbies and interests, and they didn't get together in the morning to chat about fishing. They would meet, and they had everything in common, meaning that they shared everything together. Their time, their food, their money, and their experiences. They were together as often as they could be, and they did life together. They walked side by side with one another, so they were able to share in one another's joys and one another's woes. This was a tight-knit group. They sold their possessions to give to the poor. They met in the temple courts in order to share the gospel in a public space to be a witness to the unbelieving. They broke bread or ate food together, and they worshiped and they enjoyed one another. This is the church. Timberline, this is the church. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. The Church of Acts had something about them that only Jesus could give them. They had love. This is what brought them together. Could you imagine spending every day with someone you didn't love? To eat with them, to share with them, to have them in your home and up in all your business all the time? It would be miserable. So how could they do all these things? Love. But this love didn't come from them. It wasn't their love that they were passing around. It came from Christ. It was Christ's love that bound them together, and this kind of love was not something I understood entirely until God began working it out in my life. Back in January of this year, I was sitting out in the cafe talking to Bill Fredericks about my experiences from when I lived in New York City and how I missed urban culture and living among people of different races and ethnicities. We talked about the missional church and the importance of cross-cultural experiences. And then he brought up his work on Beaver Street. For those of you who may not be familiar with Beaver Street and the work there, Beaver Street is a street in Lancaster City between Queen Street and Prince Street. It is well known for its lower income housing. The neighborhood today is primarily occupied by African and American families and Latino families, but has historically been home to many minority groups over the years since the city's founding. Over time, it has gained rather a notorious reputation as a hard or a rough neighborhood due to the overall poverty level, the higher crime rate, and the generally poor condition of most of the homes and the sidewalks. So why did Bill care about this place? Because the residents of Beaver Street had been forgotten about. When you go into the city, if you ever do, you typically go to Lancaster City for its affluent life, to visit its local cafes and mom and pop shops and the Fulton Theater, or perhaps Central Market. People don't visit Lancaster City to go to Beaver Street. And so over time, Beaver Street and its people have been neglected. Bill wanted to go to Beaver Street because he believed what Jesus said when he summed up all the law and the prophets in these two commands in Mark 12:30-31. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind, and all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Bill considered Beaver Street his neighbor, and he invited me to make them my neighbor as well. He wasn't asking me to move to Beaver Street. He was asking me to love them. So I asked Bill, well, what should I do? How do I do that? So he invited me to do something very interesting. He invited me to go on a prayer walk with him. A prayer walk is exactly what it sounds like. You walk along a place and you pray for it. You ask God to show you what needs need to be done there. What is the need? Where is the hurt? Do people know Jesus here? So on a very cold January Monday morning at 7:30, Bill, Lindsay Putney, who had somehow gotten roped into this, and I met at the old Redmond's building in Lancaster, and we began walking and praying. But before we got started, Bill asked us to pray for love. I thought that was a very bizarre thing. I thought I had love. So I said, what do you mean pray for love? I thought I had love. So he told us to read Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. And if you wouldn't mind, please turning here or clicking to this passage. Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. Paul's prayer for the Ephesians. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Wow, what an incredible prayer. To pray that we can be rooted and established in love together with all the saints, and that we can grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge. After reading this, I wanted to know this kind of love. This was the love that binded the early church together, and the kind of love Bill was asking us to pray for Beaver Street. So when we started doing so, God began opening doors, literally. We met a woman named Blanca, who lost her son Tony in a shooting last April, and we prayed with her that the Lord would comfort her in her grief, and that he would calm the anger raging in her son Raphael over the loss of his brother. We asked God to restore her and to show his love for her even in her mourning. And through Blanca, we began meeting other neighbors, and we began growing in love for them as well as we heard their stories. We continued to meet every Monday morning for an hour to pray, and we began picking up trash, and we would talk to people and just love on them. As our love for Beaver Street grew, we began talking about our next steps in the ministry, how to bring them the gospel. My first thought was to plant a church on Beaver Street. Bill then challenged me about what was required to plant a church and what a church on Beaver Street would look like. We began brainstorming how a church building wasn't really practical with the setup of the street, but meeting with people was. Our answer? Home churches. This was a more familiar concept to our friends on Beaver Street than it was to me, because they were already doing what the early Church of Acts had been doing for years. Meeting together in their homes, breaking bread, and sharing everything with each other, and taking care of one another's needs. They didn't have a church building. They had each other. They were a family. Most people on Beaver Street don't quite know Jesus fully. They've heard the gospel in a way, shape, or form, but haven't really embraced this kind of love yet. And yet, they were already being a part of a family and communing together better than I was here at Timberline. So then when the shutdown happened because of COVID, we had to stop going to Beaver Street, and we couldn't gather together here at Timberline. Like I said before, I saw this as a failure, but God turned it into an opportunity. As Timberline resorted to providing online resources of teaching and worship, a small group of nine of us decided to get together Sunday mornings in my home, and at the time I was also sharing that home with Benji, and we did most of the things we do here on Sunday mornings. We sang songs of praise, we taught each other out of the Bible, and we prayed together. But that wasn't all. Because there were only nine of us, and we had no other agenda during the day because of quarantine, we were able to actually spend more time together. We spent all day together. We grew in our relationships with one another because we prayed for specific things that were going on in one another's lives. We heard the woes and the joys of what God was doing and what things were bogging us down. We ate together. We laughed together. We cried together. We took communion together. We taught one another. And we worshiped with one another. And most of all, we grew in love for one another. And something very interesting happened. As we grew in love for one another and in the Lord, we began praying for love for one another and for love for our neighbors, those who are in our direct sphere of influence. And as we began praying for that, we also began praying for love for our neighborhoods and our communities. Then this love grew into action. We began looking for opportunities to serve in our communities. And this is what I believe is the purpose of the church, to be rooted and established in love, and that love should move us to action. Now, home church worked for us over quarantine. And Beaver Street is the community that God took me when I prayed for love. But I don't think that this is the only way. I also don't think that how we currently model church here at Timberline is the only way either. I think that when we decide how to function as the church, we have to look at what God asked the church to do. In Hebrews 10, 24 through 25, the Bible gives us some insight. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more you will see the day of his return approaching. We cannot give up meeting together. That is crucial. The when, how, and where, I think, is when we need to ask the Holy Spirit for his guidance and wisdom and discernment. However we gather, though, we must hold on to these truths. And now you may flip to your handout. Why should we gather in the first place? Number one, the Bible commands that we gather together to worship. The Bible commands that we gather together to worship. That's out of Hebrews 10:25. Number two, the Bible emphasizes the importance of the local church. All the epistles were written to local churches, the churches being people groups of a geographical location, such as Corinth, Ephesus, or Philippi. Number three, when we gather together, we encourage one another. That's out of Hebrews 10:24. And last but not least, number four, when we gather, we also encourage our pastors. So my summary point in that. Why should we gather in the first place? Church is not about us on an individual basis. It's about us bringing him glory. It's not about what we get out of it. It's about what we can give to it. What am I talking about? Bring your praises and worships to the Lord. Bring your encouragements for one another. Bring love and good deeds. Bring yourself, because we need your giftings and your talents to make the body whole and complete. When we are rooted and established in love, we turn our church experience into an opportunity to love and serve one another. If I come and I expect to be encouraged or filled, then I'm not encouraging or filling any of you. Notice how Hebrews says, to encourage one another, not to be encouraged by one another. Church is about gathering together to worship the Lord our God and to love and encourage one another and our neighbors as ourselves. When we begin to grasp this, this love will take us places. It will move us to action. How do I know this? Because when we are rooted and established in the love of Jesus, we have to act. Jesus loved his church so much that he came down to us to be with us, to serve us, to heal us, and to love us. And most of all, to die for us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. We have a God who is so rooted and established in love that he acted on our behalf. He loves us so much. And so because he first loved us, we as his bride, as his body, as his called out, we too must be rooted and established in love of this kind. So, most of you know that the leadership here at Timberline has decided to not hold any services here at Timberline next week on the 23rd in order to allow the church to experiment with different models of gathering. For some, this may seem ridiculous or scary or strange or hard. To others, this may excite you. So let me explain some reasons why I want to encourage you to take this as an opportunity and not as a failure. First, if God has called us out as his church, he wants to bring us in to gather. He does not specify in the Bible where to gather. He just tells us why we should. To worship, to spur one another on in good deeds and love, and to encourage one another. I'm not convinced that our current model is the only way to do things. I believe that a lecture model church in which there is one teacher who brings a message and the body listens and applies it in their lives on their time is an efficient way in teaching a large body, but what can sometimes be missing is relationship and accountability. We cannot encourage one another if we do not know one another. I don't just mean know each other's names or what you do for a living. I'm talking about knowing one another like family. And that kind of relationship is scary and requires vulnerability. But that's where relationships grow, folks, in uncomfortable vulnerability. Home church or small group church allows opportunity to hear from everyone about what God is doing in their lives and to learn from one another and to challenge one another with love. It's one thing for Marlon or Benji to tell you to do something from here up front because you can get lost in the masses. But when someone is in your home, on your couch, and in your face, encouraging you to do something that you may be afraid to do, there is nowhere to hide. But don't let that scare you. See this as an opportunity to grow in the Lord by being with a smaller group of people who are devoted to loving you and to whom you are likewise devoted. Now, this is one model of taking the love of God and going out and sharing it with others. Another model is going and loving your neighbors. When Jesus tells us to love our neighbors, he wasn't just talking about those neighbors you like or go to the same church with. He wants us to love the people that he wants us to care about. If we only keep the love at Timberline among ourselves, then we are missing out on another one of Jesus's great commands to us, to go out and make disciples of all nations. Jesus is giving us the green light. He's calling us out and sending us forth. We should not want to stay in the same place our whole lives. Imagine if after Jesus' ascension, all of the disciples got together and they met once a week and they talked about how great Jesus was. That's it. What if they never went out and shared the gospel? And what if they never brought anyone else in? That would be ridiculously selfish of them, right? So let us not do the same. Let us take the love of Christ and the encouragements we receive from one another here and run with them to bring more love and more encouragement. Sometimes bringing people to church is not enough. Sometimes we need to bring the church to them. Remember, the word for church is ecclesia, the called out ones. So, if this excites you, I would encourage you to get a group together and go prayer walking in your neighborhood, or talk to your neighbors, or serve at a place that you haven't yet, or come with us to Beaver Street, or pray and ask God who your Beaver Street is. There are many things you can do next week to be the church and to go out and share the love of Jesus. Here are some ways that you can do that. You can call someone that you haven't spoken to in a long time and talk with them and pray with them. You can spend the time getting into the Word and worshiping with your immediate or your extended family, especially if you are not a family that often spends time together. Invite a non-Christian friend over for a meal and really take time to get to know them. Invite people over to have meaningful discussion about what God is doing in their lives and how you can encourage one another to do what God is really calling you to do. Go to another church that is racially diverse or another denomination. Whatever you decide to do next week, just go in love. So, again, to your notes, how should we go? Number one, pray for love. That's the first step. Pray for love. It doesn't have to come from you, and it shouldn't come from you, but you have to pray for it. You have to ask him to root you and establish you in love. Second, don't go alone. Take a companion with you. Take someone that is equally excited about the things that you are or wants to try new things with you. Paul usually had someone with him in his ministry, whether that would be Silas or Barnabas or John Mark. I mean, even Jesus, our Savior, had 12 people with him all the time. Last but not least, go with the Holy Spirit. Do not have an agenda. Do not go with your own two feet. Go with his guiding and go where he takes you, because he may take you to unexpected places. Now, you can go to Beaver Street, your own love and your own strength, and you can do all the good things, but they won't be God's things. You can invite people over and you can have a nice meal with them and have some good conversation about AJ's sermon. But like, that wouldn't be very interesting. So when you do these things in Christ's love, and because Christ wants you to do them, you may find yourself doing the things that he wants you to do. You may find yourself having conversations you never thought you would find yourself in. You may find yourself opening up or watching someone open up to you. And you might find yourself lingering longer, that all of a sudden it's 5 o'clock and I have things to do before tomorrow because it's Monday. So go with the love of God. Pray for this love, because this is the kind of love that has called us out, that has brought us together, and that sends us forth. Even in the middle of a pandemic, even amongst the uncertainty, even when we are persecuted, when we are rooted and established in this love, what could stand against? What I want you all to understand this as well is, it's a process. I still haven't worked it out yet. God has started working out on me, but I have not arrived. I want to know how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And my prayer for you is that you will too. I would now like to invite the prayer team up and for everyone to stand for a prayer. I would like to invite Jeff Smoker and Michelle Jones up to pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are your people, that we are your bride and we are your holy ones, that you have called us out of this world to do your work, and that you have brought us together here this morning. And Lord, we ask that you will root us and establish in your love, and that you will send us out. I pray, Lord, that you will give us great wisdom and discernment of what that could possibly look like. I pray that that will not just be a Sunday morning thing, but that will be a life thing, that we are the church all the time, that we are yours all the time, and therefore, we can do this all the time. I pray that you will root us and establish in your love, and that we will pray for this love continually. Show us who our neighbors are, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have first loved us, and that we love you, and now you have called us to love others. I pray that you will be with us, and that you will just bless us here today, and bless next week on the 23rd. I just pray for your fruit to come out of this, Lord. In your holy name we pray, amen. Before you lies the open road, full of possibility and deeds yet to be done. Take to it as citizens, as ambassadors, as friends. Dare to embrace all that the love of Christ may bring. Write new songs as the wonders unfold. Testify, for God goes with you, and his loving kindness overflows. Adventure awaits all who gain the heart of their king. You're dismissed.